Welcome to Nonprofit Stories, inspiring tales from Silicon Valley. We will explore the transformative work of nonprofit organizations and leaders who are changing our community by tackling some of the most pressing issues facing Silicon Valley. So without further ado, let's dive into this exciting conversation. Today, we welcome Lisa Millette, the Executive Artistic Director of City Lights Theater Company of Silicon Valley. They create provocative live productions that engage, inspire, and challenge audiences and artists through innovative concepts, intimate staging, and uncompromising storytelling.
America's Theater Company's problem: decline in ticket sales. Ticket sales for the latest season were down 27% from the pre-pandemic levels. This represents a loss of over $1 billion in revenue. Regional theaters closing. Last year, 20% of regional theaters had closed. This represents a loss of over 100 theaters. Lack of diversity. In the past year, 22% of Black Americans and 28% of Hispanic Americans went to a live performance, whereas 48% of White Americans did the same.
Lisa, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's my pleasure.
Please tell us about the history of your organization and how did it all begin?
Sure. City Lights Theater Company was founded by a group of artists in 1982 in San Jose. There were other theater companies that were founded that same year, so it must have been a real awesome, booming year for storytelling and theater arts. We've been in this same location since 1994, this converted warehouse on South 2nd Street between William and Reed. And it has changed a bit over the years. It started out as this small collective that was very focused on doing some storytelling of a lot of new work and work that was a little bit more provocative, and it sounded like it must have been so much fun. But when I started in 2001, I came in as the managing director alongside Tom Goff, who had just been newly appointed as the artistic director. And we've grown quite a bit, and now I'd say we always try to do three shows you've heard of and three you haven't. But we're a year-round theater company. We produce six main stage shows a year, and then we have other programs. We bring in music sometimes. We have a Lights Up series, which is works by local new playwrights, so they can hear it out loud. And we started a podcast channel during the pandemic when we were shuttered. Yep. And another program called City Lights Next Stage, which was video interviews, and sometimes we would feature musicians during the pandemic on the next stage, where a camera would be just set up in their living room and they would play music. So it was a time to try to, you know, stay as innovative and creative as possible when we weren't allowed to be in the theater performing actual live productions for folks. But the mission of City Lights is that we create live provocative productions that engage, inspire, and challenge both artists and audiences alike through innovative concepts, intimate staging, and uncompromising storytelling.
What is your personal passion behind serving the organization?
I have so much passion for leading this organization. My background is mostly in acting. I went to acting school. I am a member of the unions. But throughout my career, I started to do a little directing or a little choreographing. And I really just love rallying people around a common vision. Just, you know, getting folks all excited about one thing that we can accomplish together. And when I first started working for City Lights part-time in 2001, I fell in love with her potential. I thought it was just the energy of the space was so wonderful. There wasn't that there wasn't enough of the mid-sized theater companies where these really talented young people can graduate from these wonderful programs at Santa Clara University or San Jose State and then have a place to go and work on their craft before joining the unions and, you know, perhaps performing for the larger companies here in the Bay Area. And I just wasn't even going to keep the job for very long, and that was 22 years ago. So now I feel like my storytelling is very holistic because I have the actor background. I usually am in a play maybe once every 4 years just to remind myself how I got into this. I love to direct, and then as an artistic director, an executive artistic director, actually, I also am a producer. Wow. So I need to make sure that everything is going well for guest directors and guest artists.
Right.
And so it's been a really wonderful challenge, and I think that's why I stayed so long, is that I have never been bored. There was always a new challenge and new problem solving and new relationships to build and people to meet and stories to tell. So I'm quite passionate about the organization every day.
I'm sure about that. And that's very interesting. Can you share a transformational experience you have had involving your organization?
You know, I have a couple. There have been a couple of moments where it just felt like everything's going to change now. But I would say that I have always been a real lover of sign language.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So American Sign Language, I've just always think it's such an incredibly beautiful language. Mm-hmm. It's very theatrically, it's innately theatrical.
Right.
And I just love the commitment to the facial expressions. And one of my passions is always trying to bridge and bond communities that perhaps don't, you know, they're not intermingled very much, or maybe they're nervous about, I'm not going to understand, you know, we're not going to understand each other. And so I had this idea that I really wanted to do a play that was completely bilingual in America. Yeah, English and American Sign Language.
Mm.
But whenever I saw a production that had ASL interpreters, they were always off to the side. So the audience, you know, had to look over away from the main action on stage to get the interpretation.
I see.
The other thing I've seen is subtitles if people are hearing impaired. But that also takes you away from mm-hmm. the actual full engagement of whatever story is being
right.
told.
Right.
So what I wanted to do was find a way to have both languages represented in a play on stage during the whole thing so that the hearing audiences and the hard of hearing or deaf audiences would have the same level of engagement and the same deep experience with whatever story was being told.
Right.
Well, everybody thought I was crazy because I don't speak the language.
Mm-hmm.
I have picked up little things here and there, and I really want to take a class because I love it so much. But looking for the right play, the right story where this concept would work, took about 2 years, I'd say. And when I finally stumbled across Sarah Rule's adaptation of Eurydice, I knew that was the one.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful adaptation. It's already poetic and lyrical, and the space can be quite innovative in how you do it. There's a river. It felt like the right one because it opens itself up to some beautiful interpretation. And so I thought, this might be it. So I went to New York and I asked to have tea with Sarah Rule to get her permission. You really can't be changing things, you know, without permission. And she was very gracious and lovely. And I explained why I wanted to do it so much. And she said yes. So I was so pleased. And so I double cast the show with English speaking and American Sign Language speaking actors. So every role had a counterpart. And what was different about it was they would relate to each other and to the other characters, whether they were speaking in English or American Sign Language. So it's a little hard to describe, but that there's two Eurydice and two actors playing Orpheus. Sometimes they would, the English-speaking one would talk to the one that is speaking American Sign Language and vice versa. And they had relationships with each other. So they were both very prominent. It wasn't like off to the side interpreting. It was really part of the storytelling from beginning to end. And I was so pleased with that production. The cast was amazing. It was so beautiful to look at. And I did feel like folks that didn't speak American Sign Language and don't have any challenges around that sense felt connected to the piece, and I thought I had people say, I just didn't realize how you can kind of, if you're paying attention, the words and the signs a lot of times just make sense. And it was the whole thing just lifted me up so much from a creativity and storytelling and bridging and bonding communities point of view. Another one was further back. It was in 2003. And the company, so I had just started in 2001, but the company only did 5 shows a year at that time. And we did Richard O'Brien's Rocky Horror and the Rocky Horror Show. And we were, supposed to do it for a 5-week run, the normal, maybe extend 1 week because it's the big summer musical. Mm-hmm. And then usually the company would take, a part of July and all of August off, which didn't financially make sense to me because any money that the company had been able to save was, went out the door if you're trying to keep people on salary and such. But we could not extend that show enough. Mm-hmm. We ended up running that show for 11 weeks. The demand was so high.
I see.
And that's when we changed from a 5-show season to a 6. So that felt like a transformational moment as well. And the other real quick one is when I directed JC Superstar. Mm. And I remember telling my amazing design staff, I want the audience to feel like they are, that they are there, that they are so much a part of everything going on, that they're not just voyeuristically watching this story, but they are in this story.
Right.
And that is something that we talk about a lot. Mm-hmm. Because it's of the nature of the theater. It only seats 100. It's in a converted warehouse. The size of the audience area and the stage is actually about the same.
Wow.
So you feel this sort of like equal participation between audience and artist. And that kind of engagement is so important to us. We try to break down that barrier and that wall of artist and audience and just show that we're all doing this together. And artists wouldn't be telling stories if there wasn't somebody to tell them to.
Right, right.
And so when I said that about JC Superstar, that's such a big show. And people usually see it in an enormous theater with an orchestra pit and, far away, and the music's amazing, but you don't usually get that up close and personal with it. So for that show, we changed the configuration of the seating and built a passerelle that went all the way around the theater. Mm-hmm. So actors could come up from behind and be in the audience. It made that experience so different for everyone that saw it, because they did feel they were literally in the middle of the action, because
right.
people were singing right behind them.
Right.
And that show, basically by word of mouth only, really, mm-hmm. the cast was so excited about it, and they talked about it with their friends and family so much, that show basically sold out before it ever opened.
Wow.
And we had never experienced anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
The Rocky Horror kept selling tickets and kept extending. But this was, I just remember the pay what you can preview. Somebody said, Lisa, you have to come outside. You have to see what's going on. And I said, what?
Yeah.
And I'm nervous and running around with the last minute notes and details. Yeah. And I went outside the front doors of the theater, and there was this line that went around the block.
Wow.
And I just thought, what is happening right now?
Right.
And so we really started to double down on making sure that the audience felt really engaged with all of our storytelling. We have a really wonderful program, our nonprofit partner program, and this is tied into the same thing about deepening the engagement with the play. And so we partner with a different local nonprofit for every show connected to the theme of the play. So when we did, when we asked basically nothing of them, this is really trying to just strengthen all of us. We are stronger together. But like, for example, when we did The Waiting Room by Lisa Loomer, we partnered with the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Foundation. And for right now, we're doing Kinky Boots is running right now, and we partnered with Silicon Valley Pride.
Right.
And what we do is we give them a place in the theater where they can do their own display. We mention them in the curtain speech. We give $5 back to the nonprofit for any ticket that's purchased because they found out from them.
Right.
And then we pick a community night where they can do the curtain speech.
Sure.
And we give them 25% of the box office proceeds for that evening, no matter where anybody, if they've heard about it from them or not. So it's really our way of just giving back to our community and trying to keep all of the nonprofits strong.
Right.
Because honestly, it's not easy. Nonprofit work is really hard.
I know.
Especially in an area that values money, investments, for-profit models.
Right.
It's
hard.
It's hard. So we love that program. And so we've made good friends with some of the nonprofits that we've partnered with over the years. And sometimes we have them back. And it's been super wonderful. We commissioned a play called Truce, A Christmas Wish from the Great War.
Okay.
And it was based on that real story, that true story of when they had like a ceasefire and shared song and chocolate on Christmas. And in 1914. And it was a lovely play. And we partnered with History San Jose.
Oh, okay.
So they had the back wall where they put displays of people from San Jose and history about in that year and about the war. And so it was just a wonderful tie-in to from the theme of the play and what it was about to the rest of our community. And the nonprofit partner program is one of my favorites.
That's very inspiring.
Get a guaranteed cash offer on your home from TradeMyHome.com, powered by Your Home Sold Guaranteed Realty. We provide upfront written offers at a price agreeable to you. Experience a guaranteed sell with a hassle-free, highest and best price sell within your time frame. Are you selling your home in the next 3 to 6 months? Text PAIR to 408-740-7400 for a free and no-obligation professional equity appraisal report. Exclusively for Nonprofit Stories podcast viewers. For more information, visit TradeMyHome.com or call 408-740-7400. Remember, at TradeMyHome.com, your home is sold guaranteed or we'll buy it.
So what are some of the difficulties your organization face and how you and your team overcome them?
Well, it is 2023. And I will say the worldwide health crisis was particularly hard on certain communities. And one is theater, for sure. I just read in the New York Times these statistics that were just so eye-opening about how many theater companies have closed and downsized and all of that. So recovering from being shuttered when your business is all about being in person has really been a challenge. Restaurants too, entertainment, hospitality. We know that a lot of industries have suffered quite a bit. But I feel like a little bit with theater, there's something kind of unique about the challenge because it was so long of not being able to gather together. and experience storytelling, that habits have changed. People discovered, you know, binge watching things on their streaming and door dashing, and it's been really difficult to get people to come back out. And remember how wonderful it was to share this experience with 99 other people that you didn't know? Remember that collective heartbeat? So I knew this was going to happen, but it really is quite a challenge. That the hardest part wasn't actually 2020 or even 2021. The hardest part is now. This year, and definitely this coming year, we will still see more theaters closing, more artists leaving the field, more artists leaving the area because it's so expensive to live here. And so, you know, that might feel like everybody's challenge, but it is a unique one. How do you articulate how important it is to have the arts in your community?
Absolutely.
And it's hard to even express it. We have all these statistics about the economic impact, and if somebody goes to the theater, then maybe they hire a babysitter, they'll go out to dinner, maybe they'll pay for parking somewhere, maybe they'll go out afterwards. So every dollar spent at a cultural institution generates so much more money for the city or community in which it resides. At the same time, there is intrinsic impact that is very hard to quantify and to explain about changing hearts and minds.
Right.
And so both, to me, feel very important. But if someone's out of the habit and aren't used, you know, they're not used to getting dressed and going out, and they can have entertainment in the comfort of their own home. And there's some great entertainment out there, believe me, I know. But it's different. It's a different kind of storytelling. And I feel like right now we theater artists are having to fight to defend ourselves and to make sure that people understand how important it is to have art in our lives. I don't know a theater company, a nonprofit theater company, that the ticket sales cover, it's usually less than 50% of the cost.
Of the cost,
yeah.
Wow.
And so donations and contributions and foundation giving and corporate giving, all of that is critical for the organization, any organization like this, to survive. And in the last couple of years, a lot of the inflation has been real,
right.
The interest rates, the other very real challenges we have in this world around climate change, around racial justice. Mm. There are so many things going on at once,
right.
Those dollars are, and energy and focus is actually split in so many different directions. It was like the perfect storm, honestly,
right.
With the inflation and politics and George Floyd and the pandemic. And it was like a tornado.
Right.
And now the tornado stopped and all of the pieces, you know, are like scattered. And really what we're trying to do is just like, And by pieces, I mean all of them, the funding, the audience, the artists, the care, the love, the joy,
right.
The joy in the work, trying to collect all
collect
those
all
things back together,
yeah.
Has been the biggest challenge of my career.
And can you share another example of how networking and collaboration have helped you?
Oh, well, the parties afterwards, so that they had a place to talk about the play. We give engagement gifts that are designed for to tie into the show, the theme of the play for every show, so that they have something to take with them. It's like it could be any little gift. And then that extends and lengthens and deepens their relationship with the story and therefore with the organization. If we try to encourage the thought and the care and the effect and the engagement level of the story with the audience past curtain down, lights up, it's over, moving on, then it makes the work very powerful, because if storytelling is intended to encourage empathy and compassion, maybe change people's minds about something, show a different point of view, a different perspective, then the deeper that that can go into their hearts and minds, the better. And so we started doing all of these other activities to try to encourage that sort of deeper relationship with our audience and the work that we do. And that has become part of our DNA. So part of our culture is that we want you to engage fully. And what do you need from us in order to do that? And some of our plays have weightier, more, the themes are, they bring up some hard things. The Every Brilliant Thing, for example, addressed clinical depression and suicidal ideation. And so we try to also be of service to our community by responsibly saying, if this is something that you understand and you have a lot of feelings about, here are some resources. I think it's all about that. Sure. I think that every success story comes back to a relationship.
Absolutely.
And who you meet and who you express your passion to, wow. It's all, we're all just people.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, it's a bunch of people trying to do different things.
Right.
So, you know, networking is like making new friends and developing new relationships. The collaborations, like with the nonprofit partner program, we collaborated with Teatro Vision last year and co-produced a show,
mm-hmm.
A beautiful musical. I always tell my staff, you know, that when we're talking about, like, how do we get subscriptions back up or audience development, that the audience is not like a blanket one thing. It's each individual. All of these things have to be one human soul at a time.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that we try to do at City Lights is make sure that every audience member gets actually a personal moment, a personal contact with somebody from the inner family.
Wow.
So okay. That's one of the reasons why we give the gift, you know, because then you have somebody that is like, here, take this. Have these stickers,
right.
You know, whatever it is.
Making that human connection with one another.
Yeah. It's all about that.
Right.
And then the pandemic showed us that too.
Right.
Because we were all sent to our rooms to think about it for 18 months. And then even afterwards, you know, there was this wave and that wave. And so we missed each other. And then now I feel like people are more reliant on technology, on social media. And it's wonderful in some ways. But you can't have just that. It's not healthy. Like, we have to have this. And so that's one of the things I feel like I'm fighting for. But I think it's all about relationships and people one-on-one. You do that enough, and then all of a sudden you do have a group. And then you are developing a community. But it there's no shortcut to that. It takes a long time. It takes a lot of generosity of time and spirit and positivity, and it's one soul at a time.
And how do you envision the growth of your organization?
Well, this is a very interesting time for us because we, just to give you some context, when I first started at City Lights, the budget was about $175,000, and there was a bit of debt. Before the pandemic, our budget was $1.4 million, and there was no debt. And so that's a tremendous amount of growth for any organization without any kind of physical change, no physical move. So we are looking for a new space.
I see.
And part of the reason is that we don't own it, and it's been, the part of the block has been purchased by developers. There's a lot of development going on. And so the building will be developed, torn down, and we're renters. So that's one reason. But I like to focus on the more positive reason, and that is that we just need more space. Like, we don't have enough support space, rehearsal space, adequate office space. Our lobby's really small. If we have a sold out show, we don't have parking for our patrons. So it's actually time for us to find our next new home.
Right.
And so that has been a big learning curve and a lot of fun too. We have, you know, a broker that helps us look at warehouse space. But to be clear, we're looking for what we are now, but brighter and right. bigger and more supported. So we don't want to become a different theater company.
Right.
You know, people ask, oh no, but it's so intimate and all the seats are good and we're only 4 feet away from the actors. And I'm like, don't worry. We know that's important to us as well. So we maybe want to add 50 or 75 seats, but make sure that the warehouse space is converted and designed in such a way that people still feel that incredibly deep engagement with the artists and the storytelling. So, you know, I don't know, this seems like maybe a hard time for us to do a capital campaign and raise millions of dollars and buy a warehouse and then have it renovated, but it's what needs to happen. And it's what is in the best interest of the organization and the community that we serve. And so that's what I want to do now is like just find our new home and continue, of course, to serve in the way that we are with the plays and the artists. But at the same time, I have to secure the future, the sustainable future for the organization. And a company that doesn't want to be in a traditional theater with the orchestra pit and the fly system.
Right.
You know, that's unique, I think. If someone were to say, you know, we'll give you the Montgomery,
right.
I'd say, thank you. That's so generous. I'm not sure if that's our vibe. We're a much more, you know, urban and that kind of funky sort of downtown-y feel. And I think that a lot of good things have come out of us embracing our culture and our identity. Our audiences are, generally speaking, younger than most theater companies.
I see.
And I think that's because it's like very friendly. It's it doesn't feel precious. We let people take their concessions in with them. The younger people feel more comfortable there, and they don't feel like, oh, well, that's, you know, that's something not for me. That's my grandparents were all about live theater and where you have to, you know, don't touch this and don't touch that and all the rules. And so we try to eliminate those. And
so keep it more fun.
We do keep it more fun. We do.
And what important lessons and strategies have been vital to the success of your organization?
Well, two come to mind. One is, it's so important to think strategically. This profession is extremely difficult. And often we're dealing with what fire are you putting out today? And I find that even if you need to put out a few fires, if one can elevate a little bit and look at it a little more holistically and think strategically and have a vision of where you want to be and then map out those steps to get there, bring people along with you, that's the way to survive and thrive.
Mm-hmm.
So thinking strategically is one. And the other one is be kind. I really wake up every morning thinking we all just need to be kind to each other every day in every way. It is so missing. And we've always kind of been like that at City Lights, you know, that we say keep the drama where it belongs on stage. You know, if people are kind of jerky or judgmental backstage, they just don't work for us again.
Right.
I feel like it's really important for everybody to feel good about the work they're doing and feel comfortable in the space and all of those things and feel supported.
Right.
And so years we've been talking about that, but lately it just feels more and more important to spread that word of be kind to one another. We might not always agree on everything, and that's okay. And, you know, as long as we can still talk about it or choose not to, agree not to, but there's no reason that we shouldn't be putting more kindness in the front. I have an expression that I live by that says, lead with love, not your ego. And our egos can be so detrimental to ourselves and others because we do things out of fear and you try to protect yourself. And so I always think, nope, open heart, open mind, lead with love and kindness.
Right.
And still make good business decisions. Don't get me wrong. Nonprofit doesn't mean no money.
That's true.
You know, you still have to have a good business sense, especially here in Silicon Valley.
Right.
But you can put kindness first.
And what advice will you give to upcoming artists?
Oh, I love upcoming artists.
Okay.
I love them so much. We try to work with, you know, I try to choose plays that have roles for younger artists. I adore them. And my advice is, be kind, is that how you are to work with and be around is just as important as how talented you are, if not more. So building those relationships, being thoughtful and kind, keeping your ego in check, that will go a long way for your career. People want to work with people that they want to work with.
Mm-hmm.
And collaborate with. Theater is a team sport. It is all about collaboration. You need every person that's involved in the project.
Right.
Designers, crew, actors, director, audience.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you are difficult to be around as a human, that's going to be a barrier.
Right. Lisa, it was so interesting talking to you today. And thank you so much for your time.
I appreciate you having me. I really enjoyed myself. Thank you.
City Lights Theater Company's impact. Their summer musical, Kinky Boots, sold at 92% capacity with over 26 performances. They engaged over 85 local artists in their programming in their latest season. They presented 7 installments of their live streaming series, The Next Stage, which reached over 100 views during the live broadcasts, and has resulted in over 425 on-demand views. They engaged over 85 local artists in their programming for FY22-23. It's time for our trivia question to win prizes. This section is hosted by our AI host, Kay.
Hi, this is Kay from TradeMyHome.com, powered by Your Home Sold Guaranteed Realty. Your home sold guaranteed or we'll buy it. Here is our NPS trivia question. What is the name of the largest nonprofit organization in the United States, based on annual revenue, and is primarily focused on healthcare? And your options are American Cancer Society, Kaiser Permanente, or American Heart Association. Winners will get a $25 Amazon gift card and recognition in our next episode. Submit your entry on our website, trademyhome.com/NPS, or by scanning the QR code on the screen. Only the top 3 correct entries will win.
Thank you for listening to the podcast and acknowledging the impactful work of nonprofits in Silicon Valley. Please subscribe and share this episode with a friend. Thank you to our sponsor, TradeMyHome.com, for their community commitment and for making this podcast possible. Until next time, remember to support local nonprofits.